Welcome to Peninsula Seniors Out and About. Today we're at the Western Museum of Flight in Torrance for one of their celebrity lectures. Let's go see what Cindy has for us today.
Welcome everyone, I'm Cindy Maka, the director for the Western Museum of Flight. We of course live in the modern era of multitasking. A few people can do it fairly well. Many people think they can do it, but without any success. Today we have someone who multitasks for a living and does it very well indeed, day after day. Flying a helicopter is, by anybody's standard, a difficult and absorbing task. Coherently articulating the news in real time is an equally difficult task. Tim Lynn does both at the same time and does it on a regular basis. So today we're going to give him a break and ask him to perform a single task of sharing some of his experiences, exercising his very rare talent of multitasking. Ladies and gentlemen, our Eye in the Sky reporter, Tim Lynn.
Well, thank you, Cindy. I really appreciate the invite to come down here and speak to you folks. Normally, I can't see my audience, so this is something I have to get used to. So I talk on TV every day and don't see anybody I talk to, but here we are today. How did we get here with the news service flying helicopters? Well, John Silva, back in 1958, put the first helicopter into operation. It was a Bell 47, where he crammed about a 400-pound camera into this little bitty helicopter and got the first picture out in 1958. In fact, it was July 4th, 1958, and KTLA was the first news station with an airborne camera producing live pictures on air to cover the news. So that's where we started, and so now we'll show you where we've gotten to. We have the Sky 5 outside here. This is an Aerospatiale, or Eurocopter, AS-350. It's a French-built helicopter, and costs about $2 million just to buy the helicopter. Camera equipment on it is about another $1 million on top of that. It has a 700-horsepower gas turbine engine, so it makes a lot of noise, burns a lot of fuel, but has a whole lot of power for me to be able to hover out of ground effect and sit up there for hours on end watching the news story. It's a very comfortable flight, very most important part of that helicopter. It has a very nice air conditioner because most helicopters are not air conditioned. Max speed of about 120 miles an hour, and I can stay up there for about 2.5 hours before I have to go run for fuel. And my personal limit is about 2.5 hours because I need to get out about that point. This is my office. This is what I look like most of the time. This is over the Lakers victory rally up at the Coliseum. And this is what it looks like from above. And no, my corner office is cool. I don't know who else has an office that gets to work out of that has views like that one. And now looking inside, this is where I sit. If you notice here, this is just your standard helicopter configuration up front. The only difference is I get to watch TV. And also over here, in that area, that's the camera that I look at that my camera operator is putting on air. So whatever's in that picture is what's going on air. So I narrate from what I see there and also what I see outside. You can see there's a lot of white switches and buttons down here. Those are my favorite buttons because I have to listen to about 5 different people at a time and talk on TV and fly the helicopter. And so I've always said I'm not a reporter pilot, I'm a pilot reporter. Pilot comes first. My first job is to get back on the ground in one piece and to make sure I don't touch anything while I'm flying. So when the news side of the operation starts getting a little overbearing, I have a director in one ear, I have a desk operator in another ear, I have an engineer in another ear telling me all kinds of things, I start pushing those nice little white buttons right there and shutting them off. And the only guy I can't turn off is the anchors, Michael Ullman and Cher Calvin, and my director. Those are the only 3 people that I have to listen to all the time. But yeah, when it starts getting busy up there, I start taking off different radios to where I can handle the helicopter, handle the workload. Because you have to realize there's 6 or 5 other news helicopters in the area, and we're all doing the same thing. We're all getting there for the same picture. And it's kind of a deal. We wait on the ground until something happens, and then we all rush to it. And whoever gets there first gets the best parking place. And so if the situation is between 2 big high-rises downtown, there's not too many good parking places. So once you're there, you want to stick there. and then everybody else wants to get real up close and personal with you. So the whole time I'm talking on TV about whatever's going on the ground, my head's spinning around watching the guys around me. Luckily, the guys that are flying around me are very experienced. We all know each other by face and name. We meet once a month on a safety meeting, talk about issues that may have happened the past month, and keep everything on a very, very professional level. And we talk to each other constantly before we move. Well, that's another person I have to listen to, but nobody moves a position unless they make an announcement. So we're very, very aware of each other's position. Nobody will move out of position, because once you figure out where everybody's at, you want them to stay there, and they want you to stay where you're at, because it makes all of our jobs a lot easier. Now, this is where the camera operator sits. It's in the back seat to my left. I fly with a camera operator. He handles all of the engineering, all of the scanner systems, the radios, as far as the production is concerned, and puts that picture on air. It takes a lot of skill to be a camera operator in these helicopters, to stay oriented to where you are, to where the story is, and to get the best shot on air. My job is to make him look good, because I watch the shot. I have to keep the trees out of the way, the buildings out of the way, the wires out of the way. And every pursuit you go on, a building will always be there when it ends. A tree will always be there when it ends. And they scream at you, get the tree. Well, I know. You got to get the tree out of the way. I'm working on it. You'll see a pursuit here where the pursuit went behind a building on me real quick, but you hear me on air saying I'm going to move, because if I say it, they know I see it's behind a building, but I don't want them yelling at me over the air, because it kind of interrupts what I'm saying. So, but this is where the camera operator sits. You'll see that little laptop laying on the seat there. That's the camera controls, and he uses that to control the ball that's up on the front of the helicopter, as well as does all the what they call painting of the picture, to make sure it's all color balanced and the light balance is right. And then up here, the laptop is for our moving map. You'll notice that there's Thomas guides in there. Well, that might break, and we'll go back to old school and just whip out the Thomas guides, figure out where we need to go. But a lot of information on that computer. We had a tanker on fire up on the 60 freeway at Azusa. And they say, yeah, it's a big rig fire. And I'm okay, and I'm flying over there. And as I get closer, I start, I see the smoke. Okay, it's a fire. I get a little closer, and I see it has six of these high pressure containers, the full length, and it's hydrogen. Now, okay, it's a hydrogen fire. It's a big tanker. And then as we come rolling in on it, I realize that the firemen are now 100 yards away. Well, that's a cue to me to stay away too. And there's little placards you see on the back of the trucks that have the numbers. Well, I'm able to say to my partner, hey, what placard number is 1632? And he'll tell me exactly what the product is in that truck, so I know how far to stay away from it. But it was kind of common sense. When you see high pressure hydrogen, you might want to give it a little berth. But all kinds of information in there, and also that's how we get to the stories at 123 Main Street, someplace in Rialto. So it plus local knowledge. I've been flying in the area for over 20 years, and it comes with the time and experience to be able to get from one point to the other. But this is a camera that sits up on the front. It's gyro stabilized. That's why we have such a neat picture on air. Very, very long lens on there. So I can read a license plate from 1,500 feet. And so getting into real close. And then there's digital doublers. There's optical doublers that we can make the picture even closer. But we lose quality when we do that. That's totally controlled from the guy in the back seat. The little pod on the bottom, it's the little plastic thing you see down there, that's the microwave antenna. That's how we get that picture and my voice back to the station. It's a microwave signal. It's a very narrow beam, and we have hilltop receivers all around the area here, and the station will tell us which hilltop to send our signal to. Our computer in the back, the troll system, knows where the hilltop is by GPS. We'll point our antenna towards their antenna, and then the operator at the station will turn their antenna back to us. And once the two antennas start talking to each other, then a telemetry is set up to where now the hilltop will follow us, and then our helicopter antenna will follow the hilltop as well. But there's certain things I have to remember where the hilltop is, because if I put the night sun, which is on the back, between me and the hilltop, it knocks the signal out. If I put the camera ball between me and the hilltop, it knocks the signal off. So not only do I talk, fly, try to figure out where I am, I got to make sure I don't point the helicopter in the wrong direction. And so that's what the troll system here does, is gets our signal back. We can shoot a signal from about 100 miles, because we never know where we're going to end up. We had a pursuit start in Lakewood one night, and I ended up at the Mexican border. And we're down there over Donovan State Prison, where he crashed. and I'm 100 miles down trying to get a signal back and actually go on air and talk about what I'm showing down there, hoping everything holds, because we're right at the end of our limits at that point. So you have no idea when you come to work at night where you're going to end up. And on the back there, you see the little lens back there. That's the night sun. That's 50,000 candle power light that I use at night on certain situations. I'll use it on fires to light up the firemen who are on the roof. It looks cool because they have all these little reflective strips on their uniforms, and you can able to see it a little better. The only thing I can't do is light up a police operation, because being a former police officer, I know I don't want somebody lighting me up when I'm trying to hide. So we don't light up police operations unless we have permission. And on pursuits, we never ever use them, because there's a police helicopter below us, and we don't want him flying through the beam. This is kind of the view of a brush fire. This is up at 12,000 feet. This was the day fire up by between Santa Barbara, Ojai. This was several years back. Day fire lasted 35 days. So this is what a brush fire looks to me. But on air, you see these massive flames. That's because of that heavy-duty camera system we have. People ask me, how did I get here? How did I do this? What made me become a news helicopter pilot? Well, actually, I started off born and raised in Gardena right here. Got my private pilot's license, beating the pavement to death out here on 29 left and 29 right. Got into aviation, just really enjoyed it, flying fixed wings and just doing it to fly on the weekends. And then I met a police helicopter pilot, and that kind of put the bug in me. And I spent 14 years up at Culver City PD as a police officer. Well, prior to that, I was in the U.S. Coast Guard, yeah. To all of our veterans. Yeah, Semper Paratus. Yeah, I drove boats in the Coast Guard. So people ask me, well, did you get your flying experience in the military? No, I drove boats. So I am the living proof that bosun's mates know how to fly. So anyway, after 4 years Coast Guard, did my time up at Culver City PD and met this helicopter pilot from LAPD, and the bug hit. So I transferred down to Huntington Beach PD, spent 14 and a half years down there flying HB1 in the police helicopter down there. And thinking I was just loving this. This is the best thing in the whole wide world. I'm flying a helicopter, I'm doing police work, I'm flying. I put two of my loves together, and I've made it. And then I met this guy named Larry Welk, which is the grandson of the Lawrence Welk. And he was flying Channel 9 at the time, and we became friends. And he offered a chance for me to come up and ride with him. Well, went up and rode with him a couple times and realized that 30-mile area that I had down Huntington Beach was really tiny compared to the area he was flying in. And I really kind of dug the freedom of getting out there and flying around. And it was a completely different skill. I could fly the helicopter, but doing this new stuff was tough. So luckily, the harder I worked at it, the luckier I got. And Larry finally offered me a full-time job. And I retired out of law enforcement after 30 years with them and moved my way into the news, and been doing this since about 2004. And you know, I hate to call it a job, because it's not a job. I just love it too much to call it a job. But it's really a great deal. But it's all about, setting goals and, taking the opportunities as they come along and not sitting back waiting for something to come to you. So for our young folks out there, it's just, set the goal, go after it. And, don't give up if it gets a little rough along the way. So but this is where I sit. This is what I see every day during the brush fires. We had one yesterday out over Quail Lake that was going, and we've been really, really lucky this year. We haven't had a major fire because the setup that we have right now with the drought, how dry the fuels are, it's not going to take much to set off one of these fires that's going to get going. But luckily, they're very aggressive on the firefights. You also get to do cool stuff like this. We brought our Vera Jimenez, our weather caster down here, meteorologist down here, to do a weather cast from a steerman that parks right across the way here. So I get to fly formation with a couple aircraft out of Torrance here. It was kind of fun. You get neat stuff like that. Then there's other neat stuff you get to do. A couple years back at Brackett Airport, there was Confederate Air Force came out and brought out their B-24. And so we were going to go cover it. Glenn Walker was doing the story about the aircraft, and he was in the waist gunner's window, and we're flying right next to it. And he's talking on air while we're videoing him in the waist gunner. And as we took off from the airport, he was up sticking his head out of the hatch over the cockpit talking about what was coming up on the 6 o'clock news. And then we took off, and somebody on the ground videotaped us coming down the runway. So it looks like Sky 5 is drag racing this B-24 down the runway. man. You look back at it, you go, some of the cool things you get to do. You know, how often can you go, hey, I drug rate, you know, B24, have you? Huh? So it's kind of cool to do. Now I'm going to get into our typical day flying news. What works out is I wait at the base and I listen to scanners, I listen to police radios. I have folks that call me and say, hey, I think something's going on at where they're at. And we'll check it out. Then once my dispatch confirms that there is a story, because it costs between $2,000 to $2,500 an hour to fly this, they want to make sure the story is there before they shoot me all the way to Orange County. So we get the call to go, and we sit back and go, and then when the call comes in, get launched, and this is what a typical day in the life of a news pilot looks like. This video, I have to give credit to, was shot by Channel 3 in France. They came over doing a tour of California, showing the beautiful coastline of California, and they got up into L.A., and they happened to fly by and see a bunch of helicopters parked over a fire, and they took a bunch of video, and then flew on, and about a year later, they came back and wanted to do a story about the helicopters they saw. So it's two different times when they put this all together, and they came up with this production for Channel 3 over in France.
Get it on the air first, or get there when it's started. Like, we have a huge fire, we want to be there when this fire started, and then watch as it builds, and then they can edit that down for the news later on.
More like a pilot. Until the story starts up, then I get to put my brain into the reporter mode, because I don't talk on the aviation radios like I do on the TV.
This is an actual news story, and you can watch how many helicopters are parked right next to each other.
Large house here. It's a three-story house that's fully involved in flames. This is one of the older houses here in Echo Park. Back up in the hills, in the weeds, in the bushes and trees around it, you can see the firefighters working very hard to knock the flames down. Flames are coming out through the roof, as you can see right there. They're putting water on this fire, and this fire is really taking off through this structure, and it's going to be a complete loss. As you can see, the fire coming through the roof. Firefighters there spraying water on from all sides, shooting water in through the windows, but this is going to be quite a loss on this house. This one, like I said, one of the older houses here in Los Angeles.
So that's what a typical day looks like for me, going out handling a house fire of that sort, covering traffic, which is a big deal in the morning for the traffic and weather segments of our 4 o'clock to 9 o'clock shows. That's where they focus, but we're focused more on the night side to breaking news, such as police pursuits, fires, things of that sort. I'm going to stop right here and ask, are there any questions so far before I go to the next video? Any questions at all? Yes,
right.
Sir. The question was, do we have a certain altitude that we stack the helicopters at to stay clear of the fire department, police departments, and other news? Normally, we're about 700 to 1,000 feet above the lowest or the highest police helicopter. Fire helicopters are right on the deck, so we usually don't pay attention to them too much. They're at 50 feet and 100 feet, so if they're on fires. But over the big brush fires, we have a 2,000-foot separation to where we're way up there because we have fixed wings coming in under us as well. But all of our coordination is done over a, what they call a common traffic frequency. We have a, one frequency that all the helicopters talk on, police, fire, news, and everybody, every other helicopter pilot out there, that we keep track of each other, especially when we get condensed over a story. As I was saying earlier, you're on that frequency giving reports where you're at, where I'm at. Hey, you know, five, seven's right behind you. Okay, let me know if I back up on you, and keep track of each other that way. And the police are very, very supportive, and we're very supportive of the police because we work together on this. And having law enforcement experience, sometimes I get the opportunity to play policeman and help out. Hey, the guy you're looking for is under the wheelbarrow in the backyard of the purple house. I'm looking at him. Oh, okay. And then they, hey, why don't you go check the, you know, yeah. We are supposed to stay separated from the stories. We're not supposed to get involved in the stories, just report them. But my cop's eye keeps popping out every once in a while, and I get in the middle of it. So end up chasing some folks around. My partner that I fly with, or actually flies for Channel 4, they had a stolen motorcycle they lost, but we stayed with it. Guy went inside of house, changed clothes, came out, walked away as the police were showing up. He just walked away. And so finally he called, hey, the guy's in the auto zone down the street. He's wearing this, 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 and this. And they drive over and get him. So we help out sometimes. Any next, way in the back.
Is your base Van Nuys or Whitman?
Whitman. We're at Whitman Airport. The Channel 11, 7, and 2 are out of Van Nuys now. And 4 and 5 are out of Whitman. Yes, sir.
Can your photographer fly with you? Can he fly the aircraft if something, God forbid, happened to you?
Well, if you'll look at the aircraft, he's got to get from the back seat to the front seat before the thing gets out of control. So, no, he's long for the ride. I do train my camera operators to fly to get at least to the ground. I had just finished one up to where he could get it to the ground, and now I have a new one back there. But he's a little bit bigger, and I don't know if he's going to be able to slide past all that stuff. And if something goes sideways in a helicopter, it's out of control before you can get to it, because it wants to go where it wants to go all the time. So it's not like an airplane where you can let go and just,
right.
No. Yes, sir.
Did I count there's 6 helicopters on the TV station?
There's 6, yeah, 6 total. We have 6 total out there, and we all end up usually at the same place, same time. Yes, sir.
Sorry.
The question was, what relationship do we have with the FAA, I'm assuming that you're asking. I have a couple of very good friends over at Van Nuys that I keep in touch with. In fact, I had one of the FAA inspectors that would come and ride with me every once in a while just to get a ride along, and then he could get a check on me and, you know, mark off a couple boxes on his deal. But the question was, how much do I have to talk to the Fed? You're talking about control towers and things of that sort? I'm sorry. A lot, because pretty much all the airspace here in Los Angeles is covered by a tower somewhere. There's very little spots where we don't have to talk to them. But yeah, I have 2 aviation radios that I have up, you know, tower radio, then the CT or the helicopter frequency. They're both on at the same time. And yeah, every time we transition all over, especially we do a lot of operations in Los Angeles' airspace under the Class Bravo, and that's, you know, ducking the A380s coming through, they'll move us out of the way for those guys. They won't let us stay anywhere as under the big Airbus that just came out. But yeah, we do talk to towers all the time when we're in their airspace. Other than that, you know, if we're uncontrolled or no, then we're just talking with each other. Well, the question was, do I have a writer that writes my scripts for when I talk on TV? No, I go with what I see. Basically, they give me the information I get from the station about a story is where it's at, what time it started. Then I go, what's going on? We're not sure yet. We're still working on it. And then you hear the director go, 30 seconds. Okay, here we go. No, I fortunately, like the other reporters on the ground who have writers who write their scripts for them and put all their videos together, the helicopter's on the fly, no pun intended. And it's a skill you have to build. I had a quick question over here real quick. The question was, do we cover parades like the Rose Parade? No. The blimp covers the Rose Parade. That's an operation that's put together. And also there's a huge restricted area, flight restriction area over the Rose Parade, and over the Rose Bowl, and over Dodger Stadium, and over Disneyland that we can't fly in.
So. Is there a dedicated 5 pilot standing by at this time, like you're doing this job?
Nope. Here he is. Yeah, I hear you now. We have two pilots for Channel 5. The other pilot's supposed to take the Saturday shift if something happens, but I took the helicopter, so now it's me, and I take the Sunday shift if something happens. We're on call on the weekend, so it has to be something pretty major to get us to come in for it. The question was, what is the age restriction for flying news helicopters? It's a Part 91 operation for folks not in aviation. There is no age restriction. As long as I can pass my medical every year, then I get to fly. I make the joke, when my walker won't fit in the helicopter, then I'll quit flying. But as every year that I go to my favorite doctor and he goes, so how long are you going to fly? And I go, how long are you going to let me fly? That's the next question that comes out. The question was, is there anything to limit, or is there any talk about limiting the time we spend over a pursuit or covering pursuits? Well, we cover the pursuits that we can get to because people watch them. And I can tell you that you can watch the ratings change as the pursuits come on. And I kid you not, they have instantaneous ratings that they can watch. If you go to a commercial during a pursuit, you'll watch your ratings drop and the other station will come up. It's not because we cover them because they're cool. We cover them, one, because they're a public service. As far as, hey, there's a pursuit in the area, here's what's coming. If you live in a neighborhood and you're police cars, you want to stay inside. So that, and also it's a news story that's happening in our city that we need to cover. The question was, what do we do in between while we're not flying? Well, we're in our station at our office, and we have scanners that are going to cover all the police frequencies, all the fire frequencies in the area. And also I watch a computer screen to watch what the CHP is doing. There's a new thing out there that I call it new because it's new to me, Twitter. There are folks out there that listen to police scanners for the area they live in and put down everything they hear. So I'll hear something on a scanner come out in El Monte, and I hear it's kind of exciting, but I didn't hear where it was or what it was. I can go right to my Twitter, look at Valley Scanner 626, and he'll have it up there talking about what's going on in El Monte. So there's all different feeds that we take to get the information to call the station. This is what I'm hearing on this frequency. Do you hear it? They'll get into it. And they're doing the exact same thing I'm doing. So we kind of double up the effort. And then once they make the determination, it's a story to fly on, then we go. And usually as soon as you hear the word pursuit, it's go. We may get launched. My record is 10 now. Getting launched 10 times a day on a pursuit and getting two of them because they end before you get there. So the question was talking about maintenance on the helicopter. How do we handle that? We have a company at the airport that handles all of our maintenance, and the helicopter has an hourly schedule, and when certain hours flight time come up, different inspections, different maintenance have to happen. Every 100 hours it goes in for a quick once over that they go through a list of things they have to check. It's coming up on an engine change here next week where they're going to actually take the engine out, take it apart, replace some parts that are what they call time limited, because they could be flying perfect engine, putting out perfect power, but there are parts in there that can only fly 10,000 hours or 5,000 hours, then they have to take them out. This is my big brother, Mike. So, the question was, I left out a little part of my career path with the DEA. I kind of glossed over my law enforcement. I did a lot in law enforcement. That helps with me doing the reporting side, because I was a dog handler for 5 years. I was a motor officer. I was undercover in narcotics. And I don't know if you ever seen the movie Jumanji with Robin Williams with a big beard, that's what I look like. And did a couple stints with the Drug Enforcement Administration working major crimes. So that was all part of my police career, kind of glossed over. Right here, sir.
Quick one. Did you cover OJ?
No, I was in Texas when OJ was going. In fact, we were sitting in my mom's living room and watching that. And that was, yeah, no, I didn't cover that. That was a long, low-speed pursuit. Way in the back, and I'll be the last one. Oh, the question was, we have 100-hour inspection. When does that come up? Every 100 hours, obviously. But the thing is that you call them 100-hour inspections, but it's actually 100-hour, it's a 200-hour, it's a 3, a 6, and a 1,200-hour. The question was, how long in days is 100 hours working this helicopter? It's about 30 days. Because it's kind of funny, because the station is contracted to fly the helicopter 100 hours every month. And they get right down to the dot every time every month. So, yes, sir. Last question. Question was, have I ever been hit with a laser beam while flying? Yes, quite a few times. It goes in spurts to where we'll have it every night. Then there's sometimes there's one guy in the Hollywood Hills who's going to be sentenced March 15th in federal court in Los Angeles, and he's looking at 7 years federal time. They changed the law just last January, reducing the what they call the intent part of it, to where it's a little easier to prosecute. And he was over the Hollywood Hills up by the Universal Studios. I was at Burbank Airport, and he had a laser that was about 1,000 times brighter than what the law allows. And the problem with the lasers are they're green, and you're flying along and you see a real bright green light flash. Well, as a pilot, you look because that's what a position light on a helicopter or airplane is, green. And you want to look to make sure it's not a plane, and you get blasted with a laser. It hurts. It causes burns to your eyes. It makes it feel like you have sand in your eyes. And at night, it gives you flash blindness where you have these spots in your eyes. So the only way we counteract it is as soon as I see it, I turn the helicopter away from it. And then my camera operator turns the camera towards it. And that's how we caught that guy that night. And with the work of the Sheriff's Department, they were able to go right to his balcony and pick him off. And like I said, he's going to be sentenced next year in federal prison. A person in Fresno just got sentenced 2 days ago for 14 years for doing the same thing. But yeah, it's the level of how aggressive they get. I've had, 9-year-olds down there blasting me with lasers, and you have to deal with that. All right, let me get this going because we're going to get behind a little bit. Now, the question about pursuits. It's because people watch them and they're exciting and they help our ratings. And here's a couple typical pursuits we've had, a little more exciting. And you have to understand that I come over a pursuit and I have to narrate what's going on, fly, have the other five guys around me, and then listen to a director and also more information coming in through the scanner, because I have to hear what the police are saying. So you'll hear this, you're going to have a couple pursuits here that kind of stand out as some of my better ones.
Breaking news at 10:30 near downtown Los Angeles, a police pursuit involving a DUI suspect.
Tim Lynn overhead in Sky 5. Tim, what do you know?
Well, we know right now he got on the freeway just about Crenshaw there for the eastbound 10 freeway. Southwest LAPD is in pursuit. He got up to about 110 miles an hour. As you see him blowing through traffic on the brakes really hard here, they've gone into their surveillance mode. LAPD air unit is overhead keeping track of it. But as we go through the turn here through Los Angeles Street, it's a red Mustang. One person in the vehicle is what they're saying. It's at a very high rate of speed coming up behind that van right there. Like I said, into surveillance mode to not cause any problems with this guy, because he was just zipping through traffic, excessive 100 miles an hour, but now he's kind of slowed down now. I'm looking way behind him. I don't see any police cars too close to him right now. You can see the air unit light on top of him. But coming up into the East LA interchange here, back on the gas, really cooking along. This is the interchange here. It's going to take him either to 10, 60, or the 5. We'll see which way he goes. And it looks like we're taking, down the 5. Looks like, this is a 65 interchange right here, so this will take him down. He has a choice here of taking the 60 or the 5 at this point through the East LA interchange. And here he goes, pushing through traffic and continuing down and get through the interchange here, see which way he takes as he comes down through here. It's just a massive different
looks
freeways
like
going. Losing control into the side wall, smash, overturned car, boom, on fire. You see other car trying to stop. That car hit very, very hard, on fire. As we come to a stop here right in the East LA interchange, see if the driver gets out of there. Car is massive, just on fire all through the cockpit. And you can see right there, LAPD now calling for the fire department to come on scene. That was a tremendous crash just as he made the transition from the 60 freeway over the top of the 5. We're on the top of the 5 freeway here. Right as you get ready to go on the 60 freeway, the LAPD area lighting it up, the police unit officers coming on scene. They'll rush up there and try to see if they can help this guy out. Hopefully he was ejected from this car when it crashed, because if not, it's not going to be very good, because that car is totally on fire. But what a crash. And he was in a, you can see the officers approaching very slowly, very slowly.
Make sure
they don't know what they have.
Stay wide on that.
We are. I'm on the driver's side now. As they come up, they're going to see what they get here. The officers are coming up, LAPD supplying the light. But wow, what a crash as he came across that East LA interchange here. picking up the, looked like he was going for the 60 eastbound, but he lost it in there. It's a really tight area right there. He made a couple little turns way too fast for what he had. You see them pulling the guy out. You see him right there. They're dragging him out. They're dragging him out. Going to take him, get him to safety. Officers risking their life to get there and get this guy out. But, man, what a crash. You can see the area has turned off his light now that we can't see exactly what's happening. But now they'll start rendering aid to this guy who just crashed really bad here on the 60 freeway over the top of the 5. And they're calling for the ambulance to come in now. But hopefully they're going to do their CPR or any type of first aid they can on him. CHP is also here. Most of the CHP officers are EMT trained, and they have medical equipment in their police cars that they can work on this guy until the fire department gets here. But that was a tremendous crash. You see the car still burning there, just destroyed, because he hit probably in excess of 90 miles an hour as he came through there, and really just smashed into the side wall there, burst into flames, rolled over, and just came to a stop. And it's TV5 above your surface, still at 1,500 feet. Okay, and then, so we're just talking with the LAPD air unit overhead, and they're keeping an eye on the car. But you see that the officers have carried him down the freeway just a little bit over to the right shoulder and rendering aid down there. You see their flashlights in the darkness. But a tremendous crash here on the freeway as he came through.
The cops he's running from end up saving his life. I mean, if he's sitting upright, clearly he's conscious.
And what a miracle that would be. I mean, when you look at how that car went down in flames, what a miracle that would be. Incredible.
Well, you see him right there. They've got their lights on him. He is moving. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. And you know, having been a police officer myself for 30 years, you know, you can be chasing the worst guy in the world, but once it turns into a thing where you have to save his life, it doesn't matter what he did or what he'd been doing. You need to kick into the life-saving mode. And that's exactly what these officers did, exactly what they're trained to do. And not just stand back and, you know, wait for the fire department to show up, but they want to put themselves in harm's way to get him out, even though he was being the knucklehead racing away from them.
Yeah.
And was the main cause of why this crash happened. But that's what police officers have to do. It's what you're trained to do. And sometimes you got to really hang it out there to save some guy who sometimes, if you look at it, isn't really worth saving if you do it. But you can't put that quantity on a man, a human life, no matter what they've done. So mm-hmm. There you see the fire department knocking the flames down on that car, but it is really a mess. But so this is going to shut down this interchange for quite a while. It's going to affect the 5 freeway as well as the 60, because it's right over the top, just past the gore point for the split between the 5 and the 60.
Imagine the story that guy has in the car behind him.
Let's take a look at some of that traffic as well, because the backup looks like it's going to be pretty bad.
And for some time, yeah. You can imagine. I mean, this is going to go all the way back through downtown into the Silver Lake area before long here. I mean, not a heavy flow at this time of night, but it doesn't take much. And there you see the backup now right in through downtown, and it will continue. They're not going to have this thing cleaned up anytime soon. It looks like a sports car, Tim. Did you ever get a read on what kind of car that was?
It was a red Mustang, semi with a TV8 or police 18 TV5. That's affirmative. And then it was a red Mustang, high rate of speed. That's what they put it out at, single driver. So yeah, it was a sports car, and it was unbelievable how fast he was going. So yeah, it's the first crash I've ever seen like this, where you get that much fire and that much crash at the end, and then to get the officers to save the guy.
Well, just that the fact that he's propped up and that he was moving, that we saw him there on the side, that he survived this crash, that the police officers that were chasing him came to the rescue and made that decision quite fast when the car was in flames. This is such an incredible police pursuit, something I don't think I've ever seen before.
No, I can't recall seeing anything like this on Los Angeles television or anywhere around the country for that matter, and this is going to be on every national newscast tomorrow. You can bet your bottom dollar on that. If you're just joining us, a remarkable and extraordinary explosion at the end of this highest of high-speed pursuits. A DUI suspect who jumped on the freeway near Crenshaw and the 10 eastbound at speeds upwards of 110 miles an hour. Tim Lynn in Sky 5 telling us it was a red Mustang that police were chasing. Again, a DUI suspect made his way through downtown Los Angeles. And as he was getting into that East LA interchange area, hard to determine at this point in the dark whether he was trying to take the 5 south, the 10 east, or perhaps the 60 east, but he somehow lost control. Unclear if he clipped the rear bumper of a car in front of him or if he just got a little squirrely, as they say, in that car, not used to driving at that high rate of speed in a very narrow passage. He lost control and spun to the point where his car exploded. And how the officers were able to pull him out before that car was fully engulfed in flames, and to know at this point that he's sitting upright on the side of the freeway alive.
Certainly is an incredible story. Of course, we're going to keep on following this. Tim Lynn in Sky 5 will continue with those pictures as well. And you can get updates on KTLA.com as well as the morning news, which starts at 4 a.m. Thank you so much for joining us here for the KTLA 5 News at 10 Sports Final with Darren Horton is coming up next.
This pursuit had been going on for about 10 minutes, and I was at that point in the pursuit to where you're running out of things to talk about, man, you're slowing it down, and okay, he's pushing his way through, and the next thing you know, he does this. And one of the little Twitter guys that I follow when we go back and forth, because at the end of that, and I got cracked up afterwards, says, "You sound like a kid playing with Matchbox cars and on your front, crash, boom, fire, oh, yay." Well, that's just me. That's what you get, and I try real hard not to get too crazy with it, but you know, I don't call myself a real TV reporter. I just play one on TV. It's one of the things about the pursuits. You're watching the other helicopters. You're looking out the window. You're seeing what's going on. You can see the crashes that are going to happen way before the audience does, because you see two cars approaching an intersection. Their closure rate is exactly the same. And you try not to get too excited about it. One, because I don't want to be excited about somebody getting hurt, but yeah, you have to then, you know, hold your tongue a little bit as they come in. But I haven't had another video that the real bad crash right in the middle of downtown. Go ahead.
Were you on the Dorner case?
Yes. Yeah, Dorner was a long, long time. The question was, would I work the Dorner case back, the ex-LAPD guy that went shooting up everybody. I spent a lot of time with Big Bear on that. She asked me this, I made a comment the last time I spoke here about these pursuits, you know, they happen at 10 o'clock. The 10 o'clock hour, the news starts at 10 and goes to 10:45, and then sports comes on at 10:45. My dream every night is to knock Darren Horton off air. Because if I have something good going on, if I have something great going on, they'll push Darren right off. And then I start getting the emails or the text messages like, "Thanks, buddy. I had a good show tonight," because we're going on. But I feel sorry for the guys on the ground, though. I have a lot of contact with the reporters on the ground. And those poor guys, they'll sit out there all day long on a story, do a story at 6, and then stay there all day, and then getting ready for their 10 o'clock hit, and here comes Tim Lynn with a pursuit. Take out the whole 10 o'clock hour. So that's kind of my ideal, and kind of snicker about it afterwards. Sorry, guys, but that's kind of neat. Now, the question was, it looked like I was the only one illuminating that site. That actually wasn't me. That was the police helicopter below me. Yeah, and luckily on that one, that word exclusive. We were exclusive on that pursuit. Nobody else got it. So that's another big deal. Yes, sir. What are my normal working hours? I start at 1:30 in the afternoon and work till 11 p.m. Unless something's going on. But it could be 11 p.m. and I'm over Beaumont and I got to get back. But newscast goes off at 11, so that's when they send us home. The question was, are the UAVs or the unmanned vehicles that the gyrocopters, the helicopters they're using now for different things, going to affect our job? More than likely. Once the FAA starts getting comfortable with it and they have their set, that's what they're in the rule making process right now with that. And I could see that happening very easily. The question was, what happened to the cute girls in the helicopters? Yeah, I know, I got a face for radio, I'm sorry. The pilots, we call them self-loading baggage. The only cute girls we have up right now is Rick Dickert and Scott Reif. That was the other cute guy, a girl, is Bill Thomas, yeah. So only a couple stations use what we call talent, flying talent, and that's all they do is sit there and talk. Our company provides the helicopter, a pilot, reporter, and camera operator. And some of our camera operators are reporters, and three of our pilots are reporters. So in KTLA, both of us that fly are the reporters, and then we have camera operators back. The guy in the morning has a very cute camera operator. So that's why you don't see the inside shots anymore. It's because it's me. Okay. Yeah, being an old Army helicopter pilot, you want to be like me. Well, there was a lot of them out there. A lot of them out there. Okay, I showed you a typical day in flying a news helicopter. And being in aviation, you know, you never know what's going to happen. And your big deal is to be able to handle a situation when it goes the other way, when everything isn't perfect. It's not your perfect day. And I call this my not-so-typical day flying news. We're over Hollywood covering a guy on a third-floor balcony shooting a shotgun. Just sitting there right next to Channel 2. In fact, in Channel 2, Dan Catalano was the pilot. Dan Catalano was also my instructor pilot from Huntington Beach PD, and I encouraged him to retire and come do what I do. And so he's a pilot and was sitting right next to me, and we're chatting. Yeah, okay, I see you. You see me. Okay, right. Yeah, I'm not going to move. And then Dan goes, "Hey, Tim, I think you're smoking." Oh, okay. And this is the inside. This is what was heard inside my helicopter, and you're only going to hear one side of the conversation. It was me talking back to Dan. So this is what it looked like from my point of view.
All right. Yeah, everything's normal here.
He just told me I had smoke.
All right, I'm putting it down. Putting it down here at just north of Highland Rough, Highland here.
Yeah, he had just told me, he says, put it on the ground now.
Yeah, I smell it. It's oil.
And when the guy that taught you how to fly helicopter says, put it on the ground now, you do.
No, I'm just putting it down an emergency landing just off Highland. I got smoke coming out of the engine. Don't talk to me right now.
I heard about that. What I didn't notice, listen to my breathing. Yeah, I thought I was handling it fine. Now you got to realize this is 5 o'clock in the afternoon on a weekday in Hollywood. You find a parking place in Hollywood at 5 o'clock. Now you got to realize the people on the station, this is all they're seeing. When it stopped there, we lost signal to the station, and that's the last thing they saw. They thought I landed in a tree. Now, the one good thing about this is that my buddy in the Channel 2 helicopter was helping me out, but they're not going to let a news story go like that. And so, Dan, you heard the conversation that I was having. Yeah, I smell it. Yeah, everything's normal. And basically on this is he told me I was smoking. I didn't realize how bad I was smoking. But when he said put it on the ground, I'm not going to argue about it. I'm going to put it on the ground. And I'm watching my instruments. I had a healthy engine all the way down, but in my mind, I was setting up for what's called an auto rotation, because had the engine quit, I wanted to get it to the ground, and where I was going to put it was on Highland, just north of Hollywood Boulevard, nice big open area there, a little bit of traffic, but it was big enough for me to get into at pretty good speeds, because you have to keep 70 miles an hour on your auto rotation coming down. So I was in that profile coming all the way down. There was some change in directions trying to get lined up. And then right at the last second, when I realized I still had a healthy engine, I still had a good helicopter under me, I had this little parking lot, and then you saw there's that turn you'll see come up, and I made that decision to make for that parking lot. So now, this is CBS's side of the story, and the guy you're going to hear is not the pilot. He is the camera operator in the back seat, and Dan, as I said before, is his pilot, so that kind of lays out what you're going to hear.
I don't know. He's talking to him right now. I don't know. I think it is. Dan, is it a problem or not? It's not a problem.
And at this point, Dan shut off the intercom in the helicopter so you didn't have to listen to him.
Looks like a... Dan. Talk to me. What is this? Does he know? Dude,
He's on fire. A lot of smoke coming out of that engine compartment. The whole doghouse is filled with smoke.
Do you have a fire extinguisher?
Yes. It won't do me any good right now.
If you guys want to come to us, we'll definitely do something on this. I don't know what he's going to do.
Yeah, I like that. Well, you can come.
I'm sure he's landing. He's got to be landing.
There's my decision. There's my decision to turn. At this point, Dan's not talking, and I like that. Hey, you can come to me right now. I can go with this. Yeah, okay. Yeah, put me on live TV. That's Highland right there that I'm coming over. And now I got signs, wires, trees. And I'm going to have to. And like I said, I made the decision to go for this parking lot because I still had a healthy engine and a good helicopter.
Fountain and Highland.
No, it wasn't.
How's the hazard pay? Yeah.
Fountain and Highland.
My best part.
Franklin and Highland.
That was Franklin and Highland if you didn't get it. So luckily I couldn't hear that.
Yeah. Franklin and Highland.
That's my camera operator. It was his second day on the job. And I look back and he's back there switching switches and doing stuff. And I said, Jeff, get out. And he did what he's supposed to, run to the front of the helicopter and get away from the blades. And there's my fire extinguisher. And pretty much I'm just going to check, see if I have flame back there. But turned out what happened was is there's the oil system got clogged, built up pressure, and started pushing oil through the hot parts of the engine. So when you put oil on hot sections of the engine and through the engine, it tends to make a lot of smoke. And the thing about this is I landed right there. I had the TMZ tour bus going by.
I had
people all the way around, guy on bicycle, just kind of ride. I mean, it's Hollywood, man, and there is some. So pretty much ended up there. It took off on social media so fast that before I could call home, they knew about it. These are pictures that are on social media. So, I mean, this stuff was on the web, on Twitter, on Facebook, before I even got to the ground. And like I said, I made the call as soon as I made sure nothing was on fire, and I made, you know, let everybody know that I was okay. And they already knew about it at home. So you can see right here that these pictures come up, another one. I think right there. And of course, Dan, after this was all over, says, yeah, we're going to nickname you the smoking lawn dart. So this is what the folks on the ground saw. In fact, the maid of honor of my daughter's wedding was on Highland, saw me fly over the top of it. This is my favorite picture. Who else has a picture like this? You know, your smoking helicopter over the Hollywood sign. I made coffee cups and sent it to the station, to my news director and to the folks there, and they thought it was not real funny, but thank you. Yes, the question was, how long was from the time I found out about the problem to being on the ground? Was about 2 minutes. Because the first part of it was like, really? Yes, it was going on. So the question was, you didn't see any fire department in that shot. It went on a little bit further. My station called the fire department, told them their helicopter was going down. LAPD saw me, and they put the call out. My next job after checking to make sure my helicopter wasn't on fire was to make sure the firemen had all showed up, done squirt water on my hot helicopter. They rolled out a full response for an aircraft down, and I thank those guys. They were there, within a couple minutes. I mean, they were just flooding the area. Coming in, along with the tour buses and everything else. But no, everybody knew I was going down before I even made it to the ground. I mean, the calls were made out. Yeah. The question was, how high was I over the story? I was between 2,200, 2,300 feet over the story. Had the engine quit, and at that point, you know, I'm sitting there and it quits, it's about 30 seconds, 30 to 40 seconds, because you're going right where you're looking between your feet. And the folks at Hollywood High School would have been really surprised. That's why once I realized I had a healthy engine, I didn't want to put it someplace that's going to hurt somebody on the ground. but also keeping in the back of my mind, it may give up on me. So I always gave myself that option and moved my options as I went along. And I tell you what, when I started looking for this place to go, I had my Hollywood High School for the auto rotation, because we do that just naturally. You sit over a story and you just kind of look down to see where am I going to go if it quits, because it's a one-to-one ratio, 1 foot forward to 1 foot down, and you're not going to go very far. So you kind of have an idea. But since I had kind of a healthy engine and everything was staying in the green, as we call it, I was able to pick my spot and fly to it, but keeping in the back of my mind that if this thing quits, I'm going to have to put it down in a hurry. And that's what you don't want to do. You want to protect the folks on the ground as much, and you want to take care of yourself getting down. But I have also a saying about, if the helicopter gives up on me, I owe it nothing. I'm going to put it where I need to put it, and if I get knocked the tail off to do it, I will. Yeah, the question was, did they cite me for illegal parking after I put it down? Funny side of that, a very Russian guy rolled up in a very black Range Rover with a lot of gold and said, it'll cost you $5,000 to leave your helicopter here. So welcome to Hollywood. Yeah. The question was, have I ever seen anybody shoot at me or know of somebody shooting at me? Not really. I have not seen it. We cover stories where people are shooting, and we are really aware of that. My boss, Larry, was over a guy with an AK-47 shooting it, and he said, you could see the thing going off. And he goes, I knew he was shooting at me when the flame all of a sudden just became a pinpoint. You could see the flame this way. He went, so yeah. We probably get shot at more than we know, because you fly over some pretty crummy areas, and so you get like a big sky theory, little bullet. The question is, does my helicopter have the ability to hover by itself on autopilot? No. I have to fly it constantly. No, there are very few three-axis autopilots out there. Okay, the question was, do I have an alternative of going down with the helicopter, which I guess you're saying bailing out of it?
Right.
Yeah. No, I don't wear a parachute. And I don't think you've had a very successful jump if you jump out, because it's going to eat you alive as soon as you get out the door. They experimented way back with helicopters that would blow the blades off, and then you could jump out or it'd eject you. But I don't know, Tom, you probably know more about that than I do, so no. Yes, the question was, did I fly out of that parking lot? No. The fact the mechanic goes, yeah, it looks like it's all right. Why don't you go ahead and light it off and hover it and see if it's okay? And I went, no. No, I'm not going to. We're gonna take. So the boss finally showed up. Larry showed up and says, absolutely not. They craned it up onto a flatbed and drove it back to Whiteman and took the engine apart. It turned out to be a very minor thing, but it was major to me. Yes. And now, going back to that landing, to tell you what a gentle bunch we are as pilots, and for all the pilots in the room, you know, they were really nice to me about this. You know, took care of me when I got back to the office, make sure I was okay, and then they bought me a cake. And this is the cake. And if you notice the smoke coming out of the engine. Yeah, so that's the kinder side of my buddies I work with. And that's the end of my presentation. I thank you all for coming.
Thank you for watching Peninsula Seniors Out and About here at the Western Museum of Flight in Torrance. I'm Betty Wheaton. I'll see you next time.